Does God exist? Despite the increasing secularization of our culture, 80% of Canadians still say yes. An astonishing 44% go further, saying they have a relationship with Him. But what does that mean in practical everyday life? And how does one relate to an invisible God?
What kind of a relationship do you have if you can't hear the person you have a relationship with, you can't see him and you can't feel him? I mean, what kind of a relationship is that?
Most of us would love to hear God as clearly as Charlton Heston did, playing Moses in the Ten Commandments. There are many examples in the Bible where God spoke to people. So why isn't it happening today? Prolific author Mark Verkler decided to find out.
And so a hunger built within me, I want to do that. And I tried, it didn't work.
Really? So what kind of efforts would you make to try to hear the voice of God? What did you do?
Well, I'd quiet myself down. I'd listen real close. I'm listening for a voice, and I'm expecting a booming bass voice, audible voice, something, you know, Damascus Road experience. Nothing happened.
And as far as being out of church.
But Mark didn't give up.
I assumed, first of all, I must be doing something wrong. So I would try different approaches. You know, I thought maybe if I just read more scripture, then I could hear the voice of God. So I'd sit down and read through the whole New Testament and listen. Still no voice. So I thought, well, if I fast, maybe then I could hear the voice of God. So I'd fast and I'd get skinny, but I still couldn't hear a voice. So I thought, well, if I go to Bible college, maybe I'll become spiritual, then I can hear the voice. So I got a 4-year degree and still couldn't hear the voice, any voice, you know?
6 years of unsuccessful efforts brought Mark to a low point in his faith.
At one time, I wondered whether Christianity was real. You know, I said, if it doesn't work for me, maybe it's not real. So I backslid and quit for few weeks at a time at different points, you know. And then I decided, no, it has to be real. And I finally decided, I have no idea how to make this work, you know, but I still love the Lord even though I can't make it work, and I'm still going to follow Him even though I can't make it work.
Another 4 years passed before the issue came to the forefront once again.
Well, I had an impression come to me, why don't I take a year of my life and learn to hear the voice of God? And I had never spent 1 year to learn any one thing in my whole life. So I took a year of my life, 1979, and I focused on learning to hear the voice of God the whole year. Every book I read was on prayer. Everything in the Bible I read was on prayer and the voice of God. Every conference I went to was on prayer and the voice of God. Everything I preached on all year was on prayer and the voice of God. So I spent 1 year focused on one issue.
And that was the year Mark finally got what he wanted, a conversation with God.
My life has been transformed by the voice of God. I mean, I was healed personally. My marriage was healed. My wife said that when I learned how to journal, she got a much better marriage. Because I quit pressuring her. You know, God said, Mark, just love your wife just the way she is. Don't pressure her to be anything else. Just love her. Now, that's pretty simple Christianity, but I wasn't doing it.
Once that door was opened, Mark was surprised at what God had to say.
I think the first thing was unconditional love. He wasn't hitting me. All right, I was whipping myself, saying, oh, you miserable sinner, you know, you failed again. I come to God, and He said, it's okay. I said, don't you want to hit me? He said, not really. I said, God, hit me. He said, Mark, let it go. It's covered by the blood. Just let it go. So I came into touch with unconditional love. I'd read about it. I'd memorized the verse, God is unconditional love, but my heart, I didn't believe it.
Surprisingly, the keys Mark learned were simple.
There's four things you have to do at one time. Quiet yourself down, fix your eyes on Jesus, tune to spontaneity, and write. It's as simple as that. You do four things at once, not two, not three, four. If you do those four things at one time, you will hear the voice of God, absolutely guaranteed.
Once Mark understood God spoke through spontaneous thoughts in his mind, the process became easier. But he says writing it down is key.
Because it removes the biggest block that people have from hearing the voice of God. Biggest block I had and most people have is when I come to God and ask Him to speak, a thought will light up in my mind and I'll say, wonder if that came from God. Now, is not faith. Is doubt. So, you know, the Bible says if you come to God, you need to come in faith. So if I'm coming in faith for 2 seconds and then say, I'm shifting the doubt, jamming the receiver, cutting off the flow. Now, when I journal, I don't have to say, I can write in simple childlike faith. I can believe it's coming from God, and I can write and write and write until the flow is done. And when the flow is done, then I can go back and I can say, and I can test it with scripture.
Testing it is an important last step.
We have a lot of safeguards. The primary safeguard is you want to have 3 spiritual advisors. And you say, God, who have you placed around me who knows the Word of God, who can sense your spirit, who's willing to give me some time, and I can take and share my journaling with them. and you read it to them, you let them read it, you email it to them, whatever, and ask them a question. Do you feel in your heart that's God?
All journaling should be in agreement with the Bible.
Journaling would be personal prophecy, and the Bible says prophecy comes for edification, which is to build us up, for exhortation, which is to encourage us along a course of action. You know, Mark, love your wife. Don't be so judgmental. That's exhortation. And comfort, which is, Mark, I love you. It's okay. Let's press on. So those are the three categories for journaling for prophecy in the New Testament. So I'm assuming that my journaling will be primarily in those three categories, and it is 99% of it.
We decided to put Mark to the test. So while we were taping, he asked God what he would say to those watching. Here's what he believes God said. I hunger for them to hear my voice so desperately. This is what I have created them for. This is what I have called them for. This is my heart's passion for them. I love them, and I want to give myself to them.
Well, I'm going to share a story of how the Lord taught me how to hear his voice. I got saved at 15 years old.
Mark's own personal breakthrough in hearing God's voice has opened that door for thousands of others. He's been teaching seminars around the world for the past 20 years.
Every time I see a person begin to journal, my heart just breaks up. You know, I love it, because I know that they will never be the same. I know that they walked from darkness into light, they walked from religion into Christianity. I know their whole life will be transformed if they will keep it up and not quit. And so I tell them what to do to keep it up and not quit. And I never get tired of seeing this happen.
You've never run into a case that doesn't work?
No.
Really?
No.
Not one person.
I felt like maybe hearing the voice of God is like for those certain gifted people. But what through, like, it was so amazing. After the first class, the first day, I got to hear his voice. Now, it wasn't like in the Prince of Egypt, like, I am the Lord. Not like that.
Eric finished Mark's course just 2 weeks ago. I asked him and others what they've heard God say to them.
Things like little small issues in my life, saying, like, you need to learn to love yourself. How can you love me when you don't even love yourself as much as I love you? And small things like, I know where you come from, I know how you grew up, I know everything there is about to know about you.
He's teaching me that he's my father, that I'm his daughter, which means that I'm a princess to him, and that's something that I had never really grasped before, and I still haven't totally grasped that.
He speaks to me about, you know, who I am and who he really is, and, you know, I'll just write down stuff like, God, I'm frustrated with this, you know, what do you think? And he does speak.
And then I had a thought come to me, why don't you spend a year of your life learning to hear the voice of God? And I thought...
Mark never tires of watching the transformation happen in people's hearts.
We get people journaling 2-3 times in a weekend seminar. And we have them ask the Lord a question, and they write down what he said back, and then they share with the person next to him what they got, and I invite a half a dozen to come to the front and share. Most dramatic thing is as they share and read it, they break down and cry over and over and over and over and over again. Because when God touches the heart, it brings tears to the eyes, and he says simple things like, I love you. And they'll break down and cry. All right, now, our head knew he loved us, but we heard it in our hearts. And so as they move from their head to their heart is touched, tears come, tears are the language of the heart. So I love to see tears.
If you want more information on how you can hear God speak to you, visit Mark's website at cwgministries.org. For 100 Huntley Street, I'm Cheryl Weber.